When the U.S. first got involved in World War II, it had a small military and limited support of the people. Because of this, there was a low chance of victory. To solve this problem, the government developed a war bond campaign where every American was encouraged to participate. This path was better than alternatives like raising taxes because it gave the American people a purpose and role in the success of the war while raising enough money to fund the military. The U.S. needed a way to convince people to buy the bonds, so it turned to propaganda as a tool of communication and manipulation. It worked, but not without consequences. In the short term, the U.S. was able to raise morale and substantially increase military funding, allowing it to pay for the war. However, the propaganda increased racism in the U.S., particularly against Japanese Americans. 1. Long-term impact of the World War II war bond propaganda campaign was in how the U.S. government fundamentally changed the way it communicated about funding the military to the American people. Another and more negative long-term impact of the war bond propaganda was that it set a racist tone in the way the government communicated about people in war, which continues today.
The U.S. lost 116,000 American soldiers during World War I. In the aftermath, and because of the belief that the lives lost were not worth the victory, the U.S. decided to isolate itself from the rest of the world's problems. Due in part to post-war isolationism, peace, prosperity, and the belief that there would never again be another world war, the government decided to defund the military. But the peace and prosperity of the post-war years would not last. In 1929, the stock market crashed, marking the start of the Great Depression, the greatest economic disaster in U.S. history. Midway through the Depression, in 1932, Franklin Roosevelt was elected president. His first days were consumed with dealing with the economy. But this work was interrupted in 1939 when World War II started in Europe. At first, the U.S. did not want to get involved and only provided aid through the Lend-Lease program. President Roosevelt knew that the U.S. was eventually going to have to fight in the war. He also knew that to be successful, the U.S. would have to raise both the support of the U.S. people and money to pay for the military buildup.
To accomplish both goals, Roosevelt turned to the Secretary of the Treasury, Henry Morgenthau, who developed the Series E Savings Bond Campaign. From the beginning, propaganda was used to communicate how important it was to purchase the bonds. The first bond was sold to President Roosevelt on May 1, 1941. This marked the start of the most successful war bond campaign in U.S. history.
The outward and visible tokens of partnership through sacrifice will be the possession of these defense bonds and defense saving stamps, which are at the same time a guarantee of our future security.
According to Lawrence Olney, Associate Field Director of the Defense Bond Program, the goal was to bind the people closer to their government, not only in financial affairs, but for its total well-being. A savings bond was a share in America. Soon after the Series E savings bonds started being sold, Pearl Harbor was attacked by the Japanese on December 7, 1941, and the U.S. formally entered World War II. At this point, while the purpose of the bonds remained the same, the propaganda used to encourage people to buy them changed. After Pearl Harbor, the term savings bonds was changed to war bonds to help communicate to the American people how important their support was. Also following Pearl Harbor, Secretary Morgenthau created the Office of War Information, which was tasked with creating propaganda, promoting the sale of the bonds. It used many tools to achieve this goal, such as posters, cartoons, movies, songs, and comic books. The purpose of all of these forms of propaganda was to communicate how vital the American people's support was.
The most common propaganda type was fear. The posters communicated a disastrous outcome of what would happen if people did not buy war bonds. The fear posters have darker, fearful, and generally more racist scenes that would manipulate people into buying bonds. Most times, these messages would not be true, but they still manipulated people into buying bonds and built up racist stereotypes that would continue long after the war ended. According to historian Hannah Miles, By dehumanizing the Japanese, instilling fear in the minds of Americans, World War II propaganda posters prompted cultural and racial hatred that led to massive historical consequences for the Japanese. But fear was not the only tool that the government used. Cartoons were another source of propaganda for a younger audience. Characters such as Captain America, Batman, Superman, and Bugs Bunny helped to support the War Bond campaign.
Can't make tomorrow's plan.
Not unless you buy a share of freedom today. Any stamps, any bond today.
The reason that the cartoon propaganda worked was that the content that was being communicated was in a format that kids could better relate to. Also, this helped to propagandize adults, because kids would tell their parents about the war bond, and their parents would support the war bond campaign too. But there was a third category, and that was about patriotism. Many posters, movies, and cartoons would incite images of patriotism, which then convinced people to buy more war bonds. The scenes in these posters were mostly of families and children, or the strength of Americans in their contribution to the war effort.
The propaganda used in the War Bond campaign in World War II was undoubtedly the most successful of any other war campaign before or after it. From May 1941 to December 1945, 8 out of every 13 Americans, 85 million people, invested in $185.7 billion in war bonds. Citizens were encouraged to save 10% of their income in bonds, and many did, usually through payroll savings plans at work. This had large impacts after the war, both short and long. One short-term impact was that the government was able to communicate to the U.S. people how necessary their role was in supporting the war effort, which raised morale about the war, and the people were convinced to buy bonds. However, in the short term, the propaganda also increased racism in the U.S., particularly against Japanese Americans. One of the primary long-term impacts of the propaganda was that it fundamentally changed the way the U.S. communicated about funding the military to the American people. The war and the U.S. not being prepared to fight it taught the U.S. leaders that they could never again be unprepared to fight another war. Another primary long-term impact of the war bond propaganda was that it set a racist tone in the way the government communicated about people and wars, like in the Korean War and the Vietnam War. In the end, the propaganda about the war bonds was successful in both the short and long term, but these successes were not without consequence.
Ladies and gentlemen, let us all sing our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see?